things for people. And I just want to say, before you drink, make sure that you got somebody that can drive your butt home. So go ahead and follow the rules, and everything will be cool. And don't be no fools. Peace, baby. Warren G.
A reminder that friends don't let friends drive drunk. A public service message brought to you by the Ad Council, U.S. Department of Transportation, National Association of Broadcasters, and RAD.
Good afternoon. Let me turn that sound down. Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome into After the Whistle. I am your host today, Jimmy Cody, with my co-host here, Jeffrey Bozzi. Jeffrey, how are you doing today?
Pretty good, Jimmy. I'm really excited. We got a lot going on this week, but especially tonight, we got a big thing to talk about tonight, but a lot going on right now. And I'm doing well. How about you? How are you doing?
I'm good. How was your weekend?
It was fun. I know we were celebrating for your birthday.
Yeah.
So that was obviously a great time. But the weekend was good. Got a lot of work done. It was nice to spend time with friends as always. It was overall a good weekend. Yeah.
Yeah. Same here. I can't complain. Obviously, there was a lot that went on in the sports world, but we got to focus on the big thing from this weekend. And Saturday, we had the Final Four. Coach K went out a loser in what was a great game. A great game down to the wire. I mean, you knew it was just going to be like that too. And I don't really know what more Duke could have done, because Carolina's offense was on fire. I mean, besides hit free throws, because Duke was not a very good shooting free throw team in that game. I mean, North Carolina's like looked like a team that could win the national championship in that game versus Duke. They played flawless, I thought, on offense.
Yeah, I thought so too. And they had the shot making at the end. I mean, you saw Caleb Love make that huge three-pointer. Brady Manek is a sharpshooter. I mean, he's an absolute sniper. And they dodged a bullet because Baycott, their center, he rolled his ankle, but he should be good to go for tonight. But yeah, they're coming in high. I mean, Carolina, throughout the year, they were like this pretty decent team, but they weren't really wowing anybody. And then all of a sudden they're just catching fire at the right time, like we talk about all the time on this show. But yeah, they're riding high into this game. They obviously just beat their arch rival. They have a chance to win the whole thing tonight and their first year post Roy Williams. How about that?
Yeah. And Roy Williams was pumped at the game. He was absolutely thrilled with the way they were playing. And it was cool to watch him, be happy and celebrate his team, especially because that was the guy that he picked to replace him. And, you know, it's just nice to see him be happy for the team. And oddly enough, the team that they're going to play in the championship tonight was Roy Williams's former team before he came to Carolina in 2003, I believe it was, Kansas. That's who won the other Final Four matchup. And, you know, for the Kansas-Villanova game, I think the one theme is Villanova just didn't have the firepower to, you know, catch up to Kansas.
Right. And Abaji came out. He went 4-for-4 from three. He really set the tone. And the rest of the team really fed off of that. I mean, they were making shots left and right. And then McCormick was just too much down low. Nova just didn't have the size to deal with McCormick. I mean, he really took control of the paint, and he was just a huge presence. And that'll be an interesting matchup tonight, McCormick and Baycott.
Yeah, I agree. That is going to be an interesting matchup. But, you know, one thing that I was scrolling on Twitter and I saw this was, it was comments from Bill Self, the coach of the Kansas Jayhawks. And he said, you know, if we're going to beat them, we have to shoot well from three. And oddly enough, he said this, I guess Kansas only has something like 91 made free throw or three pointers. And I guess Manek and Love on their own have 91 or have 90 alone.
Uh-oh.
So it's like, I don't know. I mean, it's insane. Like, it's very insane. I don't know like at what point this was from, but this is what he said. So, I mean, listen, like, I do agree that North Carolina's offense is like a superpower, but I think Kansas is right there. Like, I think Bill Self's kind of selling the team a little short. I understand the three ball might not be their strength, but still, I think they're a very good team. And I think Kansas or North Carolina could win. Like, I think it's a coin flip, honestly. I know the line favors Kansas, I'm pretty sure.
I believe so. I think it was 4 or 4.5.
Yeah, it was 4. And I think that's kind of a lot. I'm very surprised, but
I do think that is a lot.
I guess we're going to see what happens.
You could make an argument, though, for both teams winning. I agree with you there.
Oh, I agree with that. You could make a case for either team. Now that I look at things, too, let's look at these two teams. They both have star players. They have the star power. You know, Carolina has Caleb Love. And then, you know, Kansas has Agbaji. He's like, both are great players. Both are more than capable players. You look at the rest of the team. They have other key guys who can play. Like, we know about Manic. We know about, how do you pronounce the center's name for North Carolina?
Baycott.
And then, you know, with McCormick and the other guy, and Brown too, that the Kansas has, you know, these guys can play. There's no doubt about that. They've been playing well all tournament. And honestly, it's the two hottest teams right now. So that makes it more exciting. Honestly, give me a prediction tonight, Jeffrey. Who do you like?
So I've been telling you about this earlier. I've been vacillating between these two teams. I mean, I had Kansas winning. When we came into the Final Four, I thought Kansas was going to win. And then I've been looking at UNC, and I'm like, they really look really good right now. But you know what? I'm going to stick to my gut and my original pick. I think Kansas is going to squeak it out.
I like UNC. I think that they're just riding on this high, and I don't know if they're ever going to come down. Also, too,
that's a great point.
Not to not like miscredit Kansas, but like, who have they beaten in this tournament? Like, let's be honest.
Like the best team that they've played?
A damaged goods Villanova team who lost their second best player? Really?
Yeah.
That was the team they played in the Final Four.
The other best team they probably played was too Providence.
Who are they? The Big East regular season champs? I mean, they didn't do anything that really impressed me all season.
Yeah, I guess a part of me,
I don't know. I just
think Bill Self was going to get a second one.
Sure, but I just look at the paths here, and I'm like, Carolina's been to the dogs, you know?
Baylor,
right? Oh, there they go, right out of the gates.
They had to deal with the Peacock stuff with St. Peter's.
They had to play UCLA.
Right.
They had to play Duke. I mean, they're battle tested.
They've beaten some blue bloods.
But this is the same thing people thought last year. They're like, oh, you know, Gonzaga went through everybody who's tough. And, you know, Baylor just kind of had the easier path there. And then Baylor played so much better.
Yeah.
I mean,
you're right about the paths. I mean, Kansas definitely had an easy path.
I said that too. I said that in a round of 32.
That's right. You did say that. You were like, Kansas has got a really easy path to the Final Four.
Yeah.
And they ended up getting there. And
the only team I thought that they might not be better than was Auburn, and Auburn lost.
Yeah. It's a really tough game to predict.
I know. And it's a real shame too, because if Houston had beaten Villanova, I think they would be in the championship.
Because they would have played.
They played so Kansas. Bad. They played so bad.
Yeah.
I think they could have beaten Kansas.
I probably would have picked that to beat Kansas. Yeah.
No, I would have. And it's kind of stinks just because we'll never get that matchup. But tonight's matchup is going to be phenomenal. What do you think about Coach K? Like, obviously, like, I've been pretty clear that I am not the biggest Coach K fan. But, you know, nonetheless, still sad to see him go. You know, he is the greatest college basketball coach of all time. I think that's acceptable to say, even though, you know, John Wooden is a great coach, too. And Pat Summitt, great coach too. But I mean, you know, Coach K's legacy, he's going to be known as a winner since he won. And also too, I think he's going to be remembered for, you know, just year in, year out consistency. That's another thing too. It's like rarely, if ever, was Duke like a poor program. You know what I mean?
Right. They were always relevant.
Yeah, always. And then also, I mean, if you're a UNC fan, I mean, you got to be happy you took Coach K out in the last game, right? Like, you have to be so
pumped. It was the dream scenario.
Yeah, I was going to say. And now he goes out with a tie record against Carolina.
I think it's what, 50 and 50?
50 and 50.
Yeah, and that was the first time they played each other in a March Madness game.
I know. So what are your lasting memories of Coach K here?
Well, you're right. I mean, he always had Duke at a relevant level. I mean, they're always good every year. He was there for how long? 40-something years? I mean, he's been the staple of not just Duke, but college basketball. And the whole basketball world's going to be missed because obviously he coached Team USA for a while too. But yeah, I mean, people came to Duke because of Coach K. Like, that's why they got all these high recruits. I mean, it's one thing, obviously, you need the team to be good. You need to be good to get good players. But yeah, he always got good players, and he found a way to have success. And you can say what you want about him. I mean, I never really minded them. I didn't really just like Duke when I was younger because they would win it like every year. And I'm like, oh, I want a new team. But yeah, I don't mind Coach K. I know you have some other thoughts about him.
I just think that he just acts all high and mighty and holy. And he's the same as everybody else. He acts like he's above everything.
Like he receives special treatment like that.
Sure. But at the same time, like he like acts like he's this like patron saint of college basketball.
Yeah, that's a good way to put like, it.
You know, he's a jerk. Like I'm going to be, and I don't care that he's a jerk. Plenty of guys are jerks that are athletes that I like, and I don't care, but don't act like you're above it though. That's my thing. Don't act like you're not. Like he kind of comes off as a hypocrite.
Okay. Yeah.
That's it. That's just my opinion.
I can see that.
The student reporter thing was like really rubbed me the wrong way.
Right. And that was interesting.
And the Dylan Brooks thing.
Oh yeah. I forgot about that too.
Those were the two for me. Also too. I always too, you know, he always acting like he was like this big guy on discipline. He had like the dirtiest players, like Christian Laettner,
Grayson Allen,
right. JJ Redick.
Well, I forgot another off the court thing was, do you remember earlier in this season when Banchero got in trouble?
Yes.
Because he was in the car with Coach K's grandson who's on the team. Nothing happened there.
Yeah, I know. I mean, I don't really know the specifics of the case.
I think it was Coach K's grandson was, I think, driving while intoxicated.
Mm-hmm.
But Banchero was in the car, but he was encouraging for him to do it.
Oh.
But, like, nothing happened. I don't know. Kind of went under the radar.
Yeah, it did kind of go under the radar. I kind of forgot about that. I think it rings a bell now. But, yeah, that's the team. That's not him. So
That is true. I don't know.
Well, it is him, actually, because he is responsible for the players. But, I mean, I don't know.
A part of me feels bad that he went out with the loss.
No, I don't feel bad at all.
But at the same time, I don't know. It's a tough way to go out, obviously, against your rival. It's not like it's any other game. I mean, you're playing your rival in a Final Four game.
Yeah. You think there's any chance he doesn't retire?
I don't know. I'm not getting Tom Brady vibes from this one. I think he's done for good.
I don't know. I wouldn't be surprised.
He takes 1 year off and comes back?
I wouldn't be surprised. Especially if Duke has a bad season?
Maybe. Hey, we'll see.
Or what if he goes somewhere else?
You think he would go somewhere else?
I don't know. I don't think he would, honestly. We'll be honest. What places could really hire him?
I don't know. Unless some big, big name school. I was going to say,
it has to be like a big time school.
And like a blue blood.
Yeah, it's got to be a big time program.
Or like in like an SEC or like Big Ten school. I don't know. ACC school. I don't know. Something like that.
I mean, let's think about all the major college basketball schools. Out on the West Coast, the really only two big ones you have are UCLA and Gonzaga. I don't think he's going
anywhere. And Arizona just hired new coach.
Arizona too. Arizona's a big program out there. So those three now. In the Midwest, we got Kansas, we got Kentucky. I don't think either of those coaches are going anywhere.
The East Coast, you got Duke, who has a new coach now.
Yeah.
UNC as a new coach.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't see him going to another ACC school.
I don't either.
Maybe Florida. I don't know. They're a pretty big athletic school. I mean, wouldn't be surprised if they
How about like LSU?
It's true, but they have a lot. I don't know if you heard. Did you hear about what happened with LSU?
Did all their players transfer?
All their players are in the transfer portal. They have no scholarship players. They have.
But do you know why? I don't know why.
So I do know why. All their biggest recruits for next year just pretty much said, no, we're not coming. Decommitted. And the reason is because they fired their coach, Will Wade. And also they have a bunch of, I guess they're getting investigating like for like something that Will Wade did. But this has been going on for years. Like we've been waiting for like, okay, it's going to come out. It's going to come out. It's going to come out. Never really has come out. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Well, I guess now there's like rumors swirling that the hammer is going to get dropped on LSU. There's going to be postseason bans, like scholarships taken away. Pretty big stuff. Because I guess they were paying players when it was not allowed. I mean, it's still not allowed, but you know, it's through sponsorships and stuff. So I have no way. I really have no idea like when this would come out, but that's when it's supposed to like be in effect. Like when it would, I have no idea, but it's kind of expected to come soon.
Okay.
So that's kind of the reason, apparently, because apparently they're going to get hit. And Shaquille O'Neal's son goes there. You know that?
Right. But did I see something where he's transferring too?
He is transferring, but also his dad played there, so he may stay.
That's true.
But yeah, I don't know. But yeah, I mean, they would
I've
be
never
bad.
Seen something like that before. Where all the players just transfer at once.
I heard it happened at a couple. But this also Murray State also had that problem.
Right.
Too.
I did hear about that as well.
And then the worst team in D1 basketball this year, they were called IUPUI. It's called Indiana University of Purdue. And I don't know what
University of Indianapolis.
Yeah, it's like something weird. It's like us. They both are combined, I guess, like sponsorship.
I think you can take it's weird. I think they offer degrees from Purdue and degrees from Indiana, but it's like at the same school. It's a weird concept.
And it's in Indianapolis.
I think. You hear it's funny where I heard
and they
about,
have their own sports teams.
Where I heard about IUPUI was from Key and Peele, the East West video. Because someone had like the fake name and then the college was Indiana University, Purdue University of Indianapolis.
Yeah, it's like very weird. Well, anyway, like a lot of their players transferred too.
Okay, yeah.
So this is like the only things I've heard of these mass transfers things. I mean, listen, like sometimes like a domino thing. One person leaves, then everybody else leaves. So like, oh, this guy's leaving and I'm leaving. You know
well,
what
speaking
I mean?
Of the transfer portal, as it relates to the game tonight, Brady Manek is a transfer. He was on Oklahoma last season.
Mm-hmm.
And look how integral he's been to UNC.
Yeah, I know. Yeah, he's been huge for them. Huge.
He's got a chance to win it all for them tonight.
Yeah, I know. It's going to be a good game. It's definitely going to be a good game. I cannot wait. In fact, I'm thrilled.
Mm-hmm.
So let's move on to another topic. And this is something that I just noticed. And I don't know if you saw this, Jeffrey, but it was like Buster Only, obviously the reporter for ESPN, tweeted out all the salaries by team. And I look at some of them and they are so low. I mean, the Orioles, the Guardians, the A's, I mean, Cincinnati. I mean, these are so low. It's insane. Like, I think it's the Orioles. I don't think they have a player who's making more than like $7.5 million.
Wow.
And as a team, I think they're like around $30 million for the team total salary.
Are you serious? That's
yeah,
so low.
Garrett Cole is getting paid like 32.5 per year. It's insane.
Which is more than the Orioles team total.
Exactly.
That's crazy.
It's insane.
Yeah, I did not hear about this.
And I just, at the same time, like, there is way too big of a gap between the big markets, the big teams, and the small teams in baseball when it comes to spending money. And it's really bad. And I think it's a huge problem that they have. You know, especially when we see a team like the Dodgers who win the World Series and they get better.
They have a huge payroll.
Yeah, they probably didn't win it last year. The Braves won it last year, but they won it 2 years ago. But they're still looking to improve. Whereas the Cubs, they won a couple of years ago, and they're like, oh, no, we don't want to keep paying people anymore. Which is so silly.
I don't know if this is the website you found. Maybe this is another website. But, yeah, the Dodgers are number one on this list at $234 million.
Yeah.
Yeah, the Orioles are dead last. This says $24 million.
Oh, okay, that's even
your
less.
List is probably more accurate.
Oh, I mean, I'm
looking at this website.
It's bad. It's awful.
And I don't know how accurate
really,
it is.
That's really bad.
The Phillies are fourth. I'm surprised by that.
No, I mean, they said they were going to spend stupid money a couple of years ago.
I mean,
ago.
They did. Harper, Realmuto, Castellanos, Schwarber.
Yeah, I mean, I was just amazed by that when I was like thinking about it. Also, too, baseball. I know I'm not here with the Yankees. Apparel on. How about the Mets? I mean, tough weekend for the Mets.
Really tough weekend.
Oof. All right. So the first thing was Jacob DeGrom is going to be shut down for a month. And in Mets terms, getting shut down for a month means missing half the season. So, like, let's be honest
that's
with
true.
Ourselves.
Yeah.
The fans know it's true. That's why they're getting mad. I mean, it is going to be really. Oh, also, too, I don't know if this affects you in any way. I just saw this, but. Apparently, you go to the Phillies games, right?
Mm-hmm.
They're bringing back Manco and Manco pizza?
They're bringing back Manco and Manco pizza? Really?
What? Yeah, what is
it's
that?
Good. It's good pizza.
Okay, well, it's just, I don't know why it came.
Are you serious?
I don't know why it just came up, but for some reason it did. It says Philly's reintroduced Manco and Manco pizza, so I have no idea.
I'm actually sure. Really happy about that.
Okay. It's
quality pizza.
Well, anyway, speaking of good food, and I hate to do this, but the Citi Field is by far the best, like, stadium food that I've ever, like, in terms of options, it's phenomenal.
They do have good food there.
Yeah.
I love the stadium in general, like, the looks of it and everything.
The only thing, I like, too, how there's just all so many weird entrances. Like, you can go in through the back of the stadium. It's just a random street. It's so bizarre. It's actually kind of, and then you walk through the parking lot, and then the tennis, too. They have the tennis next to it.
Yeah, the U.S. Open is right by there.
Yeah. It's right next to it.
Mm-hmm.
Flushing Meadows.
Right.
That stadium is a pain to get to, though. Such a pain.
Is it harder to get there than the Yankee Stadium?
They're both kind of like just not near anything.
Yeah.
I mean,
it's also New York. So I mean,
I know. I guess if I,
you know, there's traffic.
Yeah. It takes forever to get to Citi Field from New Jersey. But also at the same time, at least they have parking there. Yankee Stadium, there is no place to park your car. You're just better off like.
Is there no main parking lots?
No, there's no main parking lots at all.
So do people just walk?
There's garages.
Uber,
there's like places that you could park a couple miles away and walk. It's pretty much just, hey, whatever happens, happens.
Mm.
No, but there's no like official Yankees parking lot, no. So yeah, very interesting. Or you could take the train. That's one. But anyway, back to the Mets here. And also too, we hear Max Scherzer has hamstring problems.
That was the other news, right?
That is, I think, bad because that is something that you don't really ever recover from. That just lingers. If I was the Mets, and I'll say this now, I say this every single time with the Mets, and I said it last year when DeGrom got hurt, and then he got hurt again, and he never played. And everybody was mad when I said this. But you don't need to rush these things, especially when you have the championship caliber team that they have. You have 162 games. If he misses the first month, which I think is smart for them to shut him down for a month, then just let him miss the first month. It's not a big deal. As for Scherzer, if he needs to miss the first start, then okay. Like, you don't need to rush him out there.
Well, also come in, he had shoulder problems.
That's true. That's another thing. Like, you don't want to mess this up in the first week of the season just because you want to have your guys out there. Like, yeah, of course you want to have your guys out there, but who cares? In the grand scheme of things, especially when you want to expect to compete for championships, you know what I mean? The Warriors didn't rush Klay Thompson out there like, hey, you need to play, you know, game one, even though he's missed 2.5 years.
Right.
I mean, let's be honest. Like, it's just stupid. Like, play the long game. You don't need to play the short game.
Yeah. It's especially concerning with Scherzer because he's 38, 39 years old.
Yeah, I agree. It's very
And they gave him a huge deal.
Yes.
And they have this short window of time where they're trying to win a title, which I think they can do. I mean, they have a great roster.
They definitely have the potential. Yeah,
like, I picked them to win the East this year. I also did it last year and backfired because Mets are going to Met.
Yeah,
that's
Mets,
the same.
Mets are definitely going to Met.
But yeah, I mean, top to bottom, they've got good pitching. Their lineup's pretty good. I mean, bullpen's not that bad. I just feel like every year it's like one or two guys go down and then the whole team just is in a tailspin. It's like every year. It's unbelievable. I feel like DeGrom, it's like often he just gets hurt.
Yeah, he gets hurt very often.
He's a great pitcher. He's probably the best pitcher in the league.
I agree. He's the best pitcher in the league. So moving on too, we want to talk about some other sports. Your boy Ben Simmons is not going to be playing for the – he's not going to be ready, it says, for the play-in tournament for the Nets. I don't think he plays this year.
Yeah, I mean, to be honest, I wasn't surprised to hear that because they were trying to get him back for the actual playoff series, which I'm assuming they're going to make. But
mm-hmm. I don't think.
I think they'll be fine for the playing because like you should be able to win at least one game with Kyrie and KD.
I agree.
Like, yeah, it might depend on who you play, but they should get out of the play-in. But yeah, they could really use Simmons' defense because I don't know if you saw the other night, they played the Hawks and KD had 55 points and Kyrie had 31 and they ended up putting up 115 as a team for their total and they lost the game. They need defense. That's the one thing that they need if they're going to make a championship run. Because we know that they can score, and they have two of the best scorers in the league. And they could really use Simmons. I think Simmons can be that spark plug because he can guard 1 through 5.
Yeah, exactly. He can guard 1 through 5.
He's quick. He's 6'10". Like, he's got the size. He's got the instincts.
You don't get that often. You know what I mean?
I mean, he was a defensive player of the year finalist last year for a reason.
Yeah. No, he's definitely a more than capable player when it comes to his defensive talent. We know that.
And then you could... As a bonus, you could maybe get 15, 20 points out of him. Yeah, you could still get points out of him because, like, he can still go to the rim and get layups and dunks, whatever. Obviously, free throw shooting and anything associated with shooting is a problem for him. But, yeah, I mean, if they get his points as a bonus, that's great because they have Curry and Mills who can shoot too. I mean, they have the makings of a team who can go far. It's just like, will they get everyone healthy at once? I don't know. We'll have to see.
Yeah, I think it's interesting, and I don't know if you saw this too. I know we're going back and forth here from basketball to baseball, but Carlos Beltran was talking about the whole Astros situation this weekend.
Yeah.
He works for the Yes Network now, so he's going to be doing like some Yankees games this season.
Wait, who is this again?
Carlos Sorry. Beltran.
Oh, Beltran.
Yeah, yeah.
You know what? I didn't hear about this, but go ahead.
And he was he talked to some reporters about it, and he was basically like talking about the situation. Was like, nobody ever told him to stop. That was one thing that he said. Is like, it's kind of why it kept going. It's just nobody told us to stop, whatever. We didn't care. And also too, you know, how this whole thing is like, especially Altuve is like, was he involved? Was he not involved? You know, guys like Correa and Bregman, star players. I'm trying to think what other star players they have because they have a lot.
Correa, Bregman, Altuve. They had Springer at the time.
Springer,
right?
Springer too.
Yeah.
Who kind of fell off? Who really fell off? I understand last year, you know, the whole thing, but you know, he I don't think he's been as nearly the same player as he was in Houston. George Springer. Anyway, Josh Reddick too is another guy who played for them,
right?
And,
forgot about him.
And I guess the whole thing is basically how Altuve wasn't involved. Well. Now Josh Reddick's out there saying, oh, I'm not involved. What if all these guys, and I just want to talk about this, what if all these guys are just saying, oh, I'm not involved, I'm not involved? At the end of the day, they're the ones who let it go on.
Right.
Like, how can you act like you're not a part of it when your team won the championship?
Well, and it goes back to the punishment. I remember they were doing the investigation, Rob Manfred said that we decided not punish individual players because we didn't find evidence that, like, someone actually did it.
It's insane.
I know, that's crazy. Well, and I remember Mike Fiers, I think that's how you pronounce his name. He, I think, got traded that year to the A's. And then he came out like a month or two later and on the record said, yeah, they've been cheating. But no one believed it at the time. And then we obviously saw what happened. They got caught. But yeah. And I felt bad for Beltran, though, from another perspective, that he lost the job with the Mets. He was the manager, and he lost that job.
Yeah, I didn't think he deserved to lose that job.
I actually thought if he was the manager, because all of my friends who are Mets fans, they all despise Luis Rojas.
Yes. He was not the number one option for the job. He was not qualified for the job. Right. He wasn't good at the job.
And I was going to say, if Beltran ended up keeping his job as the manager, I think they would have been really good.
I think he would have been a good coach.
Obviously, they have that past history where they like start out well and then they choke every year. But I don't know. I felt like he would have kept it together. Beltran.
I think he would have been a good coach too. I agree with you. Like, I did actually think that he was a good manager. I wouldn't have mind the Yankees taking a chance with him, honestly. Mm-hmm. I liked him too. I thought he was good as a player.
And now
he was great.
See how,
he was a great player.
I forgot actually. That they have Buck Showalter now.
The Mets do. Yes, they have Buck Showalter, which. You know, what do you think about Buck Showalter? I mean, I always think like, you know, he was a coach for the Yankees too, obviously.
And he's obviously the manager of the
Orioles.
Orioles
too. You know, he's remembered for not putting Zach Britton in the game, unfortunately.
Yeah.
which hurts for him. But I think still good coach.
I mean, he was decent here in Baltimore. I mean, they had a few.
I think he was more than decent. I mean, look at the team he inherited and he got those guys to play hard. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I mean, they had some bad teams,
and he steadily improved that team. I mean, Chris Davis was a Rule 5 pick that they at least got something out of for a couple of years. I know how his career ended, but he was a Rule 5 draft player. So, you know, not much expectation there. You're hoping you can get a little something, but, I mean, for the most part, that was a team that was kind of just put together. that they he got to play hard. They did have some star players like Machado, you know.
Chris Davis at the time.
Chris Davis became a star, but, you know, he wasn't like some major prospect.
Adam Jones,
yeah, but he had been in the league for a while.
Right.
So, you know, I mean.
They had some good teams.
Trumbo, too, a guy who improved.
Mark Trumbo.
Once he got to Baltimore. Yeah, I mean, you know, I think Buck Showalter's a good coach. I think he's a good coach for the Mets just because the Mets are such a dumpster fire that they always find a way to have the ship sink. And I think he's someone who can manage that.
I think he could stabilize the whole situation.
I think so, too. I think he's a good coach for the situation. I will say this, though. That team to me, and I swear this, and this is just how I view them. I think that team is either going to be great this year, the Mets, or they're just going to be an absolute dumpster fire. Like, I, like, see no in-between.
Like, you think their peak's, like, 90, 95 wins?
Oh, I could see them winning 100.
Big 100?
I could see them winning 100. They have the talent.
But you could see them also faltering and winning, like, what, 80-something?
Yeah, no, I could see it just being a dumpster fire of the year where we just sit here and go, like, same old Mets. DeGrom was hurt. Mm-hmm. Scherzer doesn't pitch well.
You think they'll be a playoff team, though? Fill out your predictions.
All right, I'm going to be honest. I think them and the Mets, or them and the Braves are, like, the best two teams in the division.
Yeah, I agree with that.
But I don't know. I just don't know for like how much better they are than the Braves. Like, I think the Braves are really good. And I understand losing Freddie Freeman is really huge. But also getting Matt Olson.
It's a good pickup.
It's a good pickup. And they still have, you know, their other star players. They still have Ozzie Albies.
They're getting Acuna back.
They're getting Ronald Acuna Jr. back. You know. They're going to be
Dansby Swanson. They're the best infield in the league, I think. They got Austin Riley at third.
Yeah, no,
he's great.
Yeah, they have good players. I mean, they're pitching, like, you know, it is not. I don't think it's on par with the Mets. If I'm being honest, that was something I was very surprised about the Braves, like that they were able to overcome that.
Right.
But at the end of the day, they still are the champs. I don't think they win it again, the Braves, but I wouldn't be surprised if the Mets are there playing for a title. I think they're the one team in the NL. You're asking me who can, like, take down the Dodgers. I think it's them just because they have the good enough pitching.
The Mets?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Because there's not really a team in the Central I would take.
I wouldn't take the Brewers.
The Brewers are probably the best team
in the division. I don't think the Cardinals can. I'm interested to see the year the Giants have. Was it last year? Fluke, or like,
I don't know. They won 100 something games.
I don't think anyone saw that coming last year.
They have a few injuries, so they're going to be a little depleted to start the year. But they have a very deep team. They've got a lot of players that you've probably never heard of. They give you like Tampa Bay Ray vibes. Like, they have all these players who are like lesser known. They have some star. Like, they did have Posey. He retired, but they still have Crawford and Belt. I mean, they're respectable guys who are still good. They have all these other guys you've never heard of that are like really like Logan Webb. It could be like an ace. Like, he's good. They're going to be interesting to watch because they got a tough division. Like the Padres, you can't ignore them either, even though Tatis is hurt again.
I mean, yeah,
it sucks because he's great. He just can't stay healthy.
Yeah. Didn't he get into like a scooter accident?
I think so. That sucks.
Yeah. It's not a good way to go out, especially with your star player. You don't want to begin the year like that.
Right.
We're going to talk more baseball. We're just going to take a quick break. We're going to come back right after this because I want to get into the AL after this. We kind of just hit on the NL there. We'll talk some AL when we get back. And then also, too, I want to discuss a little NFL because there's still something that kind of interests me. So we'll be right back after this. All right, everybody, you're back in here listening live to WLOY. This is WLOY's sports show, After the Whistle. Back in here after the break. So obviously we just hit on the NL in terms of baseball. Now we're going to move over to the American League. And then also we're going to talk about a little football and the Masters too, because I want to talk about some golf with you. I know you're a big golf guy too, Jeffrey. And, you know, the Masters, you know, that's when spring really hits. When the Masters is on and I see, you know, the green beautiful every year, you know, I love watching the Masters. It's always so beautiful there. And then also too, the music that's on in the background. Yeah. Very nice and
nice
calm.
And dramatic.
Yeah.
Nice, calm, dramatic.
Yeah. Music. And ESPN's playing like the whole round they'll play it in the morning. Then they'll play it in the afternoon. They'll show you the highlights and then they put it on again at night. Oh, just hit that. And then they just play it again at night too. So you can really get your golf fix. I will say that is probably the best thing that ESPN does besides Little League World Series is the Masters, but also too, at the same time, I'm pretty sure the Masters controls the coverage. That's why.
I think so.
Yeah. Like I remember reading something. It was like, they wanted to make a change once. And it was like, the Masters were like, no, you're not changing that. And they're like, oh, well, we own the rights. And like, okay, we don't care. We'll just broadcast it online. Like, we make enough money. Like, we don't care. Like, we want things done our way. And that's how it's going to be. Which, hey, I think that's funny. Anyway, so back over to the American League now. Obviously, I'm a lot more biased than you when it comes to the topic of the American League. Because I seem to think that my team is going to win the championship every single year, which is history has told us is not true. So what do you think about the American League? You could start us off here.
So obviously it's very power heavy when you look at the AL East. I mean, there's four good teams. I mean, when I'm talking about the Yankees, Red Sox, Blue Jays, and Rays, I mean, you could argue all four could make the playoffs, which in this new format is possible. Then you look at the AL Central, which is definitely a weaker division, no doubt. But there's one team that really stands out there. It's the White Sox. But then there's other teams there that usually pop up once in a while. Like the Twins have potential. They could maybe, if things go right, could maybe get in the playoffs. And then there's like other teams like the Tigers and Royals who are on the rebuilding side, but they've shown signs that they have some good young pieces. And then the Guardians, they somehow find a way to be competitive every year. But then you look at the West. Obviously, the Astros have been the dominant team out there, but I think this could be a year where a different team could win it. Like, you could look at the Angels. If they're healthy, like, they have a really good big three. I don't really see it happening just because I don't think their health's going to go their way. But the Astros still have Altuve and Bregman, and they got other hitters. I still think the Astros are the better team.
But let me stop you there because I don't think the Angels are anywhere close to the Astros. Like, I understand in terms of talent. But after Ohtani, what pitching do they have? Like, really, you can count on Noah Syndergaard? I don't think you can.
No, you
cannot count on that guy. He is never on the field.
No. I mean, in their bullpen, they always sign guys here and there, but it's usually not that great.
No. I
think they can make it interesting.
They got, like, some good players. Like, I'm not going to lie, but they've always had solid players, and they just have never done anything.
I'll tell you who the interesting team in that division is. I think it's the Mariners. Like, do you think they're fluky after last year? Because they had a 50 run differential. Like, are they fluky?
It's another thing like the Giants. It's a team that nobody saw last year. Not really any proven major stars. I don't know. Like, I'm interested to see. I don't know what the A's are going to be because they just pretty much sold off their entire team.
Yeah, like it sounds like they're going to be like not in the mix Well, then the Rangers are another team. They signed Seager and Simeon.
Like, them too. I agree. I'm very interested to see like what those teams are. I think the Mariners are more likely to do better than the Rangers.
Okay. Yeah, I agree with that. I actually think I picked the Mariners to make it.
Really?
Yeah.
To win?
Not the West, but to get in the playoffs. I think I had the Astros. I don't know.
And you think I don't think it's all AL East teams?
No, I don't. I think the odd team out, you might be like, what the? I don't think Tampa Bay is going to make it.
Wow. Wow. What?
No, I don't think they're going to make it.
Seriously?
Yeah, I don't think they're going to make it.
All right. Well, you got to explain that. Like, what is the reasoning behind that?
I don't know.
Who do you have winning division then? You have the Blue Jays?
Yeah, the Blue Jays. And then I got the Yankees and the Red Sox as the wild cards, and the Mariners is the other one.
Wow.
I don't know. I just think at some point, I actually don't think
they have the best pitching in the division, though.
No, I get that. I don't think their bullpen's like great, though. I think their pitching is very, I don't know. Like last year,
Starting pitching is good. I understand what you're saying.
They need Glass now back healthy.
They do.
That's a key.
And they are going to get him in the middle of the season, right?
They should. He's a great pitcher.
He's a great pitcher, yes.
I don't know. I'm not really high on their bullpen personally, but I don't know. There's something about their pitching where like they do the opener and all that stuff. I feel like at some point it's going to catch up to them. I mean, it didn't last season. It did catch up to them in the playoffs. That's why they got bounced by Boston. But I don't know. Well, I love their lineup. Like they have Wander Franco and Austin Meadows. Like, I don't know.
Well, people knock the opener. The Yankees do the opener and I'm like perfectly okay with it. Like, I don't really hate
it. No, I don't mind it. The Rays, like, I guess, know how to do it better than other teams.
They do. They definitely know how to
Kevin Cash, a great manager.
Yeah, they know how to do it better than other teams.
I think they're going to be a good team, but I think Boston and the Yankees will be better. I just have more faith.
The Yankees and the Boston probably have better lineups.
Right.
I agree with that.
Boston's got a big three now with Story, Bogarts, and Devers, and Martinez.
No, well, Boston and the Yankees lineups are loaded. Like, let's be honest here. Like, let's just talk about the Red Sox for a second. They have... In the outfield, they have Verdugo. That guy can absolutely rake. They have, what's the guy's name? Hernandez. Kike Hernandez. I keep forgetting his name.
I forgot him too.
Yeah, Kike Hernandez. He is a Yankee destroyer. The guy, every time he plays the Yankees, I swear his overall goes up like 10 points higher. This guy is just mashes against us. And then they also have... in the infield, they have Devers, they have Bogarts, they have JD Martinez. Like, these guys are all that is some solid hitters right there. I mean, those guys can play.
Yeah, that's why I like
that. I know they lost Schwarber, and I don't think that's going to affect them nearly as much as like people seem to think. But then adding Trevor Story, I mean, that's huge.
Yeah,
huge. Huge. Like I don't like that lineup was already, you know, good enough. And it's going to be interesting too, because Sale obviously injured.
Right.
And he's not like on track to come back anytime soon.
I know their pitching is a little suspect.
Their pitching is definitely suspect.
Like Eovaldi's good.
Eovaldi's a good pitcher.
But is he like a true number one? Because he's kind of treated as it. He's up and down.
I will say this. I think he's very good. I do think he's very good, and I think he is underrated. He was coming off the injury right in the middle of last year, so he was a little iffy. But he pitched solid for them in the playoffs, I thought.
Yeah.
So I don't know how you could, like, be against them.
Right.
They need Sale back. I think that's a fact.
Who knows? Maybe they trade for one at the deadline. I don't know what that's could happen.
But they could make a move like that.
If they're in the mix, they're buyers.
That's true. Their bullpen also is a little shaky. Not the greatest thing. Their starting pitching definitely carries the team, in my opinion.
Right. Another part of me, I guess, not picking the Rays to make it is like, I feel like, I don't know. It is a great success story. Like, they've been good for, what, 5-6 years now in a row? They've made the playoffs, got the World Series. I don't know. I just feel like at some point, I don't know, their, like, lack of superstar talent's going to, like, catch up to them. I don't know.
I understand that.
Like, they have Franco. Like, he's probably the superstar in waiting.
And they bought out his arbitration years already. So he's locked in.
And they have Kiermaier in the outfield and Margot. Like, they've got good defense. Kiermaier's a great defender.
Yeah. But now, like, let's look at, like, the other teams in the division. Like, the Yankees, what's their strengths? Hitting for power.
Right.
And their bullpen.
I mean, if their big three of Gallo, Judge, and Stanton, if they're all healthy, I mean, they're going to be mashing.
That's the thing with the Yankees. You like everybody talks about, oh, the Dodgers have all this talent. The Yankees have more talent than anybody. They just need to perform.
Well, on the pitching side, they need Herman and Severino to be healthy. Like, that's huge.
No, they definitely need that out of their starting pitching.
And the bullpen's usually pretty good.
No, the bullpen is good. I mean, you got guys like Green. He's solid. You know, or they have Chapman still. We know that. You know.
There's someone else I forget, too, who's, like, pretty good in the bullpen.
Well, Zach Britton is not playing.
No, someone else I forget. Can't think of who it is.
Right. From last year?
I don't know. I think they signed. Did they sign someone in offseason? I think I read it in, like, well, all sports news.
We're supposed to have
news,
this guy, but... like, Heel, Luis Heel. And also we have Nestor Cortez, too. Pretty solid pitcher. He can go back and forth between starting and the pen.
Right. And I forgot they got Donaldson.
That's true. We didn't even touch on the lineup.
And yet. Rizzo, too.
Yeah, Rizzo, we'll see. I'm not really that counting on him that much. Like, right. I understand he's our first baseman. That's fine. That's all grand and good. But, I mean, this isn't the Anthony Rizzo of 4 years ago. This is the Anthony Rizzo of now. Like,
I forgot about – it's Loy Saga. I think that's what I'm thinking of. What's his – how do you pronounce his name?
What's it – like, one more time for me? I didn't hear.
L-O-A-I-S-I-G-A. He's a pitcher. Loy Saga. Loy Saga.
Loizaga.
I can't pronounce it.
I have no idea what
Loizaga. He's good.
No, Jonathan Loizaga. Yes.
He's good. Yeah.
Johnny Lasagna. Yeah.
Johnny Lasagna.
That's what they call him, Johnny Lasagna. Yeah, Johnny Lasagna. How can I forget about Johnny Lasagna?
Yeah, he's good.
Yes. I mean, also, too, he's another guy who, like Nestor, goes back and forth between starting and in the pen. But I think Loizaga is better out of the pen, in my opinion.
Do you think their like lack of moves is going to catch up to them in the end? Like, we know they can win a lot of games now, but
my whole thing is like lack of moves. I don't think, like, that's the thing. Everyone acts like
lack of big moves.
Everyone acts like the team is like doesn't have talent. And I don't think that like the moves, like, I don't understand what more moves you can make.
Right.
You're not going to have five elite starting pitchers. When Severino was playing, when he was healthy, he was a Cy Young candidate. I don't know if he could be that again, but I still think he could be a very solid number two. Herman, when he was at his best before everything that happened, he was a solid pitcher too. I don't see why he can't be a three. And then when he got Talion too, you know, other guys that we have, I mean, you know, like Cortez, they're all solid. Like the talent is not the issue. To me, the bigger issue is performance. We can't have this Aroldis Chapman just gets blown up and walks the house in, like, for a month. We can't have that. Like, he's got to be good. We need guys to perform. We can't have Joey Gallo batting 110. Like, we can't have that. We can't have DJ LeMahieu batting 240.
Right.
You know what I mean?
He was great the 1 year.
We can't have Gleyber Torres booting balls in the infield. How about that? Also, too, I just need to throw this out there. There is, like, we talk about the talent the Yankees have. Might be the dumbest team to ever play baseball. I have never seen a team so horrendous at running the bases. Still true in spring training because Rizzo just decided to just run home the other day.
My Phillies are pretty bad.
Was out by three steps complaining about the call. I'm like, what are you doing? Like, you just shouldn't have went. So stupid. And I'm actually excited to see this kid, the shortstop, Kiner Falefa. He's playing very good. And
that's good.
And also, too, we made a trade for a new catcher. Trevino, I think is how you say his name.
Well, I was going to ask you, do you think Sanchez being gone is going to be like a big, big loss? Or?
Well, Higashioka has been killing the ball in spring training.
That's good.
Yeah, he's been absolutely destroying it, which is nice to see.
Well, because wasn't the thing about Higashioka, like, he wasn't as good of a hitter as Sanchez?
Yes.
But he's definitely an upgrade defensively.
Yes. That is going to be, is Trevino and Kyle Higashioka behind the plate. And we'll see, I guess, basically, I think they're both more than capable defenders. I have no problems with Kyle Higashioka at all. I think he's a good player.
Overall, though, I almost picked the Yankees to win the division, but I just took Toronto just because I love the moves that they made. And I just feel like they're young core.
They're young enough
to
come in. There's no doubt about that. They have all the talent. It's just about coming together and playing.
Their pitching's a question mark too. It usually is every year. Toronto, like they lost Robbie Ray. That's a big loss.
Yeah.
They signed that guy Kikuchi from the Mariners. He's not, he could help, but not like a lot.
No. So, funny, so you think the Blue Jays win the division?
Yeah. I think the Blue Jays win the division, and I think the Yankees get in and the Red Sox get in.
Interesting. I think it's going to be a really competitive division. It's going to be a lot of fun, I think.
Yeah. What if the Orioles just like enter the chat? They're not.
Yeah, I don't think that's happening. But they should start bringing up some of their young prospects this year.
Right.
It'll be interesting to see if they get first overall pick Adley Rutschman up. They can bring him up after whatever the date is in May, get an extra service year.
Mm-hmm.
And he's hurt anyway, so he wouldn't be on the opening day roster.
Yeah.
As for other teams in the AL, I mean, I know we discussed, you think the Mariners are going to be do pretty good this year.
Like, I don't think they're going to win 90 games.
So what do you think about the Central? You think it's obviously just
the White Sox.
Yeah, I agree.
I don't really see any other team. Well, apparently the Tigers are supposed to be
good. The Twins or the Tigers, right?
Yeah. Apparently the Tigers are supposed to be like 500.
Yeah, maybe the Tigers improve.
I forgot they got Baez.
Yeah, they did get Javier Baez.
They got some good players. I think the Twins could be good.
I think they could be too. Like, I wouldn't be surprised.
At the end of the day, though, I wouldn't be surprised if all four teams from the AL East, the four good ones, all make it.
I don't think anybody would be surprised. I think that's kind of the expectation.
Yeah. I don't know. I just think one of those teams is going to falter.
Probably.
And I think, I don't know. I just think it's going to be
injuries. We have no idea what's going to happen.
Right.
What if Eovaldi gets hurt? Then who do the Red Sox have as a pitcher? They have nothing.
The other thing with the Red Sox was you forget that they got all the way to the ALCS last year, but they barely like got in the playoffs. Like, you forget that too.
They did.
Like, they barely snuck in the wild card. And obviously, I know that wild card game did not go your way, but
no.
Like, it's not like they got in the playoffs so easily. Like, they had to really fight their way to get in. They're a good team, though. I think they're going to be fine.
Really quick, I know we didn't really talk about the Phillies too much, but any thoughts about them entering the year? What's the expectation?
I mean, I love what we did. I mean, getting Castellanos and Schwarber were two great bats for the middle of the lineup. But it's really going to come down to can the starting pitching be good enough, and can the bullpen be like...
Can the bullpen be serviceable?
Serviceable. That's a great word.
I don't know. We'll have to see.
Like, I like what they did. Like, signing Familia and Brad Hand, like, and Neville are all, like, I guess good moves on paper. Yeah, but like,
they are.
I don't know. We'll have to see. And I don't think offense should be a problem. Like, I think our lineup's pretty good, but we should be putting up a good amount of runs per game. The question is, though, on those off nights where we're scoring like one or two runs, can the pitching like hold up? I don't know. And we're in a tough division because like the Mets and Braves are probably the two teams we're looking up at. And you can't ignore the Marlins. The Marlins have been a kryptonite.
Don't ignore the Nationals either.
Yeah.
They're one of the best players in baseball.
They do. Yeah. I don't think they're great besides that, but you never know.
You never know. Nobody thought they were great the year they got rid of Bryce Harper, and then look what happened.
Right, yeah. I think coming in, they're not really a team anyone's paying attention to just because they were terrible last season.
No, they're not, but they also had a lot of guys hurt.
And they, like you said, Juan Soto.
And Juan Soto's a phenomenal player.
He could be the best
hitter in the league. They still have that one pitcher from the championship team. What's his name? Oh, my God, I'm doubting his name.
Strasburg?
No.
Corbin.
Yeah,
he's good. I think for the Phillies,
they can still be competitive.
If the Phillies don't get in the playoffs,
they're not that much worse than the Phillies. I mean, I know the Phillies have superpower like in their lineup,
I know they haven't proven.
The Nationals probably have better pitching.
Yeah. Also, the thing with the Phillies, Wheeler is a little banged up, and
Nola, what are you going to get out of him?
I know this is it for him. I think this is the make or break year. At the end of the day, if they don't make the playoffs, it's a massive disappointment. I think Girardi will go if we don't make the playoffs.
I don't think it's his fault. I think the team stinks.
Yeah, I agree with that. I just think he's like the puppet that they'll have to get rid of.
All right, so we have a couple minutes left. We have 5 minutes left. Really quick, I saw something that said that Thibodeau from Oregon is falling down draft boards.
Really?
Your team has 3 first-round picks.
Like, how far is he falling?
Like, apparently he's falling maybe out of the top 10.
Wow.
And I just don't get that.
I didn't see that coming. He was supposed to be one.
And I know. I thought so, too. But now it seems like Aiden Hutchinson is, like, a clear-cut number one. And I also – and I'm very surprised by that. But also what I was surprised even more was by I saw something. It was like they don't think that any quarterback gets taken 420, and I was very surprised because that is a position that gets always reached for.
Oh, no doubt.
And I would not.
Teams always treat it.
I see multiple teams who need quarterbacks in the top. The Falcons, the Seahawks. You know what I mean? You don't think they would take a chance on Malik Willis if they thought?
I think they would.
I think
at least they should.
I wouldn't be surprised. I don't really like the quarterbacks in this draft, but I will say this. Like, I'm not in love with any of them. If I was willing to reach for one, it would be Malik Willis, just because I feel like he has a lot of potential and he's very raw. He reminds me a lot of Trey Lance.
Yeah. No, that's a good comparison.
Like the situations. But also, too, he played a lot more than Trey Lance. Trey Lance is probably even more raw talent.
Wait, so is Trey Lance going to start? Like, is that a clear-cut
thing? I think
that's
the expectation, yes.
Because do they still have Garoppolo on the roster?
They do.
I'm confused.
They said they might keep him if they can't get what they want. Which I think that's the worst thing ever, because that is just going to create a quarterback controversy. What if they start off and they have played some tough teams, because they play the AFC West too, and they play the NFC West. Those are all the teams they play. So those are.
I mean, that's like 10 games right
there. That's 10 very tough games. So like, what if they start off, I don't know, 0-3, and then everyone's going to be like, bro, Garoppolo in. Oh, that's going to kill this kid's confidence. You know what I mean?
Well, I know.
That's why you got to get Garoppolo out. Like, get him out. Like, if he's not the starter, get him out, because it's just going to cause a controversy.
Right. And the thing is, they've won with Garoppolo. Like, they've gotten to.
Exactly. They have
a Super Bowl and an NFC, two NFC championships with him. I mean, you could argue he's not the guy that's going to get over the top. I mean, just look at the Rams. They got there with Goff, but they didn't get over the top. And then they got Stafford and they got over the top.
That's why I really thought that I was really surprised. I really thought the 49ers would go after Deshaun.
Yeah.
I really did.
I thought Rodgers, too, could be another name. But, yeah, obviously he stayed.
I thought it would definitely be, like, they would totally have been in play. But they must like what they see in Lance. That must be the reason. Also, too, we have about a minute and a half here. Masters talk. Like, who's your pick?
There's two guys right now I'm keeping an eye on. Cameron Smith and Scottie Scheffler. I don't know who to pick, though, because they both have been great this season. Like, they've won, they've each won, I think, two tournaments. I would go with Cameron Smith. I mean, he can really be consistent. He's probably my pick. He won the very first tournament of the year, the Century Tournament Champions, and he won the Players. I mean, he's won two big tournaments. I think he can do it again.
And then Tiger's going to play, right? That's the expectation?
Yeah, so they said he's a game-time decision.
Yeah.
Which, in golf terms, I mean, you'd never really hear that.
No.
He played last week a full round of 18. I don't know how he felt after. I mean, I don't know if he spoke to the media.
I have no expectations for him. I don't expect him to make the cut.
I mean, he hasn't even said if he's playing yet. Yeah. But if he ends up playing, obviously, it's a great story. But, yeah, no, I mean, for him to just be out there is an accomplishment in itself.
I agree.
Obviously, like, what he had to go through the last
maybe
year.
Maybe Charlie can play.
Yeah, maybe Charlie. He could honestly play well. He's probably the best 13-year-old golfer I've ever seen.
Yeah, he's pretty good.
You might be 12, actually. I don't know.
I'll take Louis Oosthuizen.
Ooh, I like that pick.
Yeah.
He's always in the mix somehow.
Always in the mix, but I remember his collapse. He's had a couple collapses.
Yeah, maybe 2022 is the year.
Maybe it is.
That's a good pick. I like it.
I know. I mean, we'll see what happens. I mean, listen, anything can happen.
Right.
I mean, it's definitely going to be interesting. And also, too, no Phil.
That's right.
Because of the whole controversy with the Saudi Elite Golf League or whatever.
Yeah.
Yeah, so going to be an interesting one. I look forward to the Masters, though.
Me too.
All right, that's all the time that we have for today. Thank you for tuning in to After the Whistle. We'll be back here on Friday at 1 p.m. Thank you.